Well, good morning. Welcome to CSIS. I'm Mark Cancian. I'm a senior advisor here at CSIS. Before we begin, I need to make a routine safety announcement. In the unlikely event of an emergency, I will give instructions about what to do. But in the meantime, please take a look at the designated exits. Today's event is part of the Maritime Security Dialogue. This is co-sponsored by CSIS and the Naval Institute. It highlights current thinking and future challenges facing the Navy, the Marine Corps, and the Coast Guard. Today's the third in our series, and we hope you join us for future events. We would also like to thank our sponsors, Huntington Ingalls Industries, for their generous support, which makes the series possible. Today's discussion is with Vice Admiral William Merz. As many of you know, we had hoped to make this a Navy and Marine Corps event, but General Berger was called away, but there's plenty to talk about on the naval side.
Typical.
Admiral Merz is the Deputy Chief of Naval Operations for Warfare Systems, Weapon Systems. So he is in charge of requirements for surface, subsurface, air, and land systems, both in the regular process and in the various accelerated processes. Admiral Merz is a submariner who has commanded on submarines and also in his warfare community. He's a 1986 graduate from the Naval Academy and holds master's degrees from Catholic University and the Naval War College. So with that as an introduction, let me begin the discussion. And as you all know, in January of last year, the Department of Defense published a new strategy, the National Defense Strategy. That strategy had some continuity with the previous strategy. It focused on five threats: China, Russia, North Korea, Iran, and global terrorism, but it particularly focused on great power competition, that is China and Russia. It also called for increased resources, which the administration has provided. But it requires the services to adjust their programs to this new focus on the high-end conflict, which had been implicit in previous strategies, but never quite as explicit. So my first question to the Admiral then is how the Navy is changing its forces and programs to align to this new strategy.
Yeah, so that's a big question. Probably talk 30 minutes just on the strategy, but I think fundamentally the National Defense Strategy, first of all, it clearly defined the adversaries. It had very direct language. Walked a little bit away from the over focus on regional conflicts, and it really coined the term of great power competition. And it also had a very distinct maritime flavor to it, which was very consistent with then Secretary Mattis's view of how conflict should be. He's very committed to fighting without borders. He sees that as the maritime domain strength. It also talked a lot about agility, adaptability, which is very inherent to how we are moving forward on our new platform designs. And when I say platform, I mean all domains from space all the way to the seafloor. On this whole movement across the spectrum from the left side of CONOPS, which you can change very, very quickly, hours, days. If you're at sea, we've all been there where this particular procedure just isn't working today. You're gonna have to try something new. And then a little bit further right on that spectrum, and this is an area where the National Defense Strategy and the CNO brought out very strongly in the supporting Navy strategy, is this focus on capability and the ability not just to be more capable, but to be more adaptable in that capability. So you got CONOPS that can happen in hours, you have capability which we've demonstrated we can adapt pretty quickly. Weeks, months, sometimes single digit years, but we can turn that capability pretty quickly now. And then having the platforms that can receive that capability. So you're seeing that probably most resident in the newer programs like the Virginia class, the new frigate coming on, which has a specific requirement to have X percentage of extra space, weight, and power for these kind of capabilities that we haven't even developed yet. We just know we're going to need it, but that ship's going to be around 30, 40 years, so you just want to build them now to hit on that adaptability theme, which kind of ends up being our hedge against the unknown. As we say, the future's getting harder to predict, not easier, and that's just the pace of technology. Nothing is linear, or if it is linear, it's going to be nonlinear soon. So developing these platforms that can absorb these capabilities to affect the CONOP and being able to move across those spectrums is very important to us, and we think very aligned with the National Defense Strategy. You know, aside from that, the partnerships that National Defense Strategy has developed from the military all the way up to Congress and industry has been very galvanizing to pull all the teams together, and we're seeing that reflected in a lot of the programs on how quickly we're developing them, the relationships, particularly with me in industry, before we define a requirement, is all kind of centered on the themes of this National Defense Strategy and doing what Americans do best. And that's this marriage between the defense and the industrial base and the ability to respond. Big theme. Mm-hmm.
What kind of future changes do you see in the Navy? The Navy is making some changes now, and we'll see some in the future. What should we be looking for?
So I'll speak a little bit near term first. You're going to see the Navy be very, very defensive of protecting the balance. And when I say the balance, it's the balance between readiness, capability, and capacity. Capacity is the number of ships, number of aircraft that we develop. Coming out of the 90s and the 00s, we saw a lot of dynamics that are manifesting now. If you walk away from your industrial base, in the complex programs that we're dealing with today, it is just very hard to regenerate, in some cases impossible to regenerate. You know, we delivered one or two submarines in the 90s, and now we see how difficult it is to ramp that production up when we have a clearly defined requirement to get bigger. And we did that with kind of eyes wide open malice, because we were in very austere funding environments just to try to keep some kind of industrial base heartbeat going here. And the bill payer for that was the readiness of today's fleet. And I think I will tell you, the president's budget that's on the Hill right now was the first budget we put up there where we're starting to see the end of that pit that we have to fill in on the readiness side. And as we put together the president's budget for 21, I think you'll see that the divot gets smaller and smaller and smaller as we start figuring out where this balance is going to be between capability and readiness. And we're just fundamentally committed to that now. The Congress and the Defense Department have agreed that 355 ships of the right mix is the right size of the Navy. And we're also coming to realize what that's going to cost and how you're going to sustain today's fleet while you're continuing to grow. Much more challenging than anybody, I think, really realized, but we're much smarter about our business now over these last three cycles of figuring this out. And I think we have a lot of allies from within the building, across all the services, through industry, and certainly on Capitol Hill, both sides of the aisle. They get it, and they're very supportive.
When we talk about future capabilities, one question I have to ask is about the future of the carrier force, because the budget had proposed to retire the Truman at midlife. Decision has been reversed, but it raised the question about what the future of the carrier force was. And of course, there are many critics and there are many supporters. Critics arguing that they're too vulnerable for this kind of fight. Supporters arguing for their flexibility, particularly in the air wing, which can be adjusted. Right. So what kind of future does the Navy see for the carrier force?
So we're absolutely committed to the aircraft carrier, and this is a case where I'm glad I'm a submariner. because I came into my job really not a lot of knowledge of carrier programs. You know, they've always been part of our Navy. They've always been part of how I've employed either my own attack submarine or, as I've gotten more senior, the other attack submarines. So I had a kind of a clean slate. And you know, when we do these threat analysis and we do the war gaming, you know, the Navy is very compelled to look at the carrier and any platform through the lens of cross-domain effects, many platforms, many regions. You know, we're often accused of being the largest and most powerful Navy, but if you look at our day-to-day operations, we're dispersed all over the planet, and the ability to move quickly and to project that power forward in peace as in all the way up to war is very intrinsic in how we build this fleet going forward. So the carrier specifically, in it's the carrier now, you know, the argument comes up fairly regularly, do we still need nuclear attack submarines? Why don't we go with diesel submarines? And it's the same kind of arguments. When you lay it across the spectrum of everything your Navy needs to do, it always comes back to these types of platforms. We are always looking for opportunities to divest from these hugely expensive capital ships that are the foundation of our Navy. But when you do a broad aperture look, nothing can replace these things that we see on the horizon. So our commitment to the carrier is the Ford class. Surrendering the overhaul of Truman was a very hard decision for us. It doesn't really affect how quickly we would have gotten to 12 carriers, because she would have retired before we got there anyway, but it certainly would have resulted in carrying more risk along the way if these other investments didn't pay off. But every study that we have done, and including a lot of the studies that have been levied on us by the defense committees and outside organizations, have all indicated that we need the carrier and we need all these other capabilities. So my job as the warfare systems is to balance those so we have the most lethal Navy we can have, both near term and long term. I really can't surrender either one. So there was a little bit of betting on the come, but we also had put that thing on the block as, hey, we can reverse this decision for at least a year, maybe longer, but it sends a strong signal to industry how serious your Navy is about moving out on these other technologies. And they were always designed to complement the force, not replace the force. But in the world of hard decisions, you got to surrender some near-term stuff to get after the future. And if you bet correctly, it'll all come together at the right times across the spectrum. The president has reversed that decision. So we are now in the throes of, all right, how are we gonna afford this? How are we gonna get it back into the program? And we'll be looking for help to do that. We'd really like to not surrender these other capabilities we surrendered that overhaul for in the first place, so we can get after this more comprehensive, more distributed, more lethal, and in some cases even more attritable force. We really do feel the carrier is as safe as it's been probably in 6 or 7 decades. You know, I always like to walk back to the Cold War when, you know, the Earth was crawling with threats to the aircraft carrier, and all our calculus had a much higher attrition than we are planning for now on our worst day. And you look at the fact how survivable it is versus any land base, and the ability to move it as far as we can move it overnight, and the continually extended range and lethality of the air wing. We're very comfortable with the aircraft carrier as part of our fleet. So I'm happy to take any questions on that, but I would ask, especially those that study this for a living, don't be singularly focused on what we call a single slice of the threat cube, because that's not the way we're going to fight. That's not even how we operate in peacetime. We're very cross-domain, very multi-spectrum, and unless you are looking at it through that lens, I don't get a lot of value out of these studies unless you come up with a new concept on how we're going to fight. And I'm always all ears on those. And then we can start evaluating what that concept might look like and the force that we need. And just one more thing on the carrier, as I've become quite a study of this platform over the last 2 years, you know, the cost of anything in the Navy is expensive. You know, a carrier is, you know, equivalent to 3 or 4 submarines. Those ratios have always been in place. And if you look at the context of what your Navy cost, as we like to say, it's the interest on the national debt is more the entire Navy budget. The increase in entitlements every year is typically more than the entire Navy budget. In real dollars, the Navy budget really hasn't changed a whole lot over the last 40 or 50 years. And then you look at what is the carrier fleet or the nuclear submarine fleet or the destroyer fleet incrementally cost within that budget, it's a pretty small percentage. So we think it's a bargain. Although if you take it in isolation, yeah, $13, $14 billion, that's a tremendous amount of money. When you put it in the context of the entire Navy, entire defense budget, entire federal budget, we think it's a tremendous return on investment.
You touched upon the Navy's global commitments. The Navy, of course, every day is out there around the world, responding to crises, engaging with allies, fighting regional conflicts. But one of the tensions in the strategy is between these kinds of commitments, these day-to-day force structure commitments that all the services feel, I think the Navy and Marine Corps maybe feel them most acutely, and the demands for a high-end fight.
Right.
The day-to-day commitments require a lot of ships, some high-end, maybe some not high-end. The high-end fight requires some very high-end ships. The strategy has this notion of this dynamic force employment, that they're going to reduce the demands on the force and build up this reservoir of up-tempo and training, which every administration wants to do. It's just very hard to say no to commitments that come down from allies and the president. So my question then is, how is the Navy dealing with this tension between the high-end fight and the need for maybe a relatively smaller number of very, very capable ships and the demands of the day-to-day deployment?
So the, as kind of dictated by the National Defense Strategy and then the revelation that we're struggling with the pace, I think what has changed most dramatically is the Navy is willing to say no to protect the readiness of the fleet. And we have a lot of efforts underway that are now very focused at a very high level on sustaining the readiness and health of today's fleet. I believe you had the Vice Chief up here speaking about the RROC, the Readiness Recovery Oversight Council, which is a council designed to really protect the fleets that if they have a demand signal for maintenance, trainers, readiness, personnel, that it comes into the RROC, and the RROC kind of puts their arms around it and shepherds it through to make sure it's funded. Right now, anything we've identified, starting with the collisions and all the way through the investigations that reveal much broader challenges, it's all been fully funded at a pace that the fleet can absorb. You know, we could certainly lob all this stuff onto the fleet very quickly, but they have their day-to-day ops, so we have to feather it in so we don't inadvertently create a scenario that's actually more unsafe than what brought all this to our attention. So we feel very confident in that we can protect the pace that we can support. And part of that is just making sure we don't overstress the fleet, but also to make sure we have the fleet ready when and if we need it. And I think everybody's very, very comfortable with those decisions. And our number of fleet commanders are very vocal about the commitments they can support with our allies, with our other services, with the exercises. And I think you're starting to see, I know we're starting to see a much healthier balance of crew rest, crew activity, and when the crews are active, what are they actually doing and how hard are you running them? If there's any positive outcome from that, it's been just preserving that balance.
You talked about new concepts, and the Navy has talked for some time about distributed operations.
Yeah.
And a new way of fighting, particularly at the high end. And I was wondering if you could talk a little about the concept and then how that is manifesting itself in Navy requirements and programs.
So the concept is called distributed maritime ops. And the news flash behind DMO is it's not new. It's very reflective of a great power type of competition, especially for an away game Navy, where day to day we have presence where we think we need to have presence, and if we get surprised, you need to be able to react very, very quickly. So staying distributed is just a way to stay safe. So being distributed, being able to concentrate effects from that posture is really the heart of what distributed maritime ops is all about. And it goes all the way back to the great wars and some of the exercises we've done. DFE, dynamic force employment, is just a subset of that on how we move around, being strategically very predictable, but tactically a little less predictable. And it's not a discrete event, it's a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle in the world of great power competition, and it's a prudent lifestyle, and it does dictate different capabilities that we need. It'll be very central to this next force structure assessment that comes out. You'll probably see an emphasis on speed, agility, adaptability, some of the other things we've already spoken about. Do we have the mix of the ships correct to support dynamic force employment and DMO? Do we have the logistics train? We're very optimized for peacetime logistics. How does that kind of look as you go through the phases of escalation if we're ever faced to do that? So as we call the off-season, between budgets, those are the areas where we have expended a lot of intellect and capital and external studies, and we've asked for a lot of help. What does all that look like as we pull together? You know, just a word on the force structure assessment, and it's always good to remind everybody, it doesn't come up with typically new concepts, new ideas. It really focuses on the Navy you have on the record to buy, and then it compares that to the demands of the COCOMs, and it forms an opinion of how many of these ships you need to do to meet those demands with some risk, with some attrition, and then you add up all those ships and then you get a number, and right now the number is 355. We certainly don't see that number going down, but it is going to be more reflective of a DMO construct that includes not just the battle force ships, but the logistics ships, the trainers, the maritime operations centers, everything that we pull together to keep this machine running.
Since we're talking about the force structure assessment,
I figured it would come up.
The Navy has moved into unmanned systems,
right,
in a big way, particularly in the surface, proposing to build two a year through the fit up. And of course, then there are aviation and undersea unmanned systems also, so that this is really something quite, I mean, sort of moved to the front of the stage as opposed to in the last force structure assessment. So first, where do you see the unmanned systems going in each one of the domains? And well, let me ask that and then I'll come back to the 355.
So we're very committed to unmanned. Matter of fact, you know, part of the calculus on the overhaul of the Truman was the reinvestment into these other capabilities. So when I say distributed capabilities, attritable capabilities, really fundamentally we're talking about the unmanned world and a lot of the enablers it'll bring or that they're going to need. So there's two elements to unmanned. One is the practicality of them, and the other is the technology of them. And we're all in on the technology. The practicality piece we're just going to have to live through. We're very pragmatic. We're very evidence-based. We have to get these things into the fleet. We have to get them into the fleet in a hurry. And we have to test them, see what they can do. You know, I use the analogy of, you know, of all of us that have been through a typhoon at sea. So you drag all these things through a typhoon and only half of them come through. Now what? I mean, what do you do with those, with the other half? What happened to the other half? Just one example of what we're concerned about on the robustness and the efficacy of these platforms. So, you know, I say that on one side of my mouth. The other side is we're all in. You know, we're pouring as much money into these systems as we think industry can handle. And we have a pretty good plan, mostly in R&D now, just because we have a lot to figure out. But we are very excited to get these into the fleet. I think we've made great strides in the air domain, but the air domain presents some overhead challenges that are much more dramatic in the undersea domain and the surface domain. Like comms, navigation, all that stuff that's hard for a manned submarine is, you know, equally hard for an unmanned submarine that we just have to come through. But we're learning from each domain. We're pouring that those lessons learned back into them. And then we also have to figure out, you know, law of armed conflict, manned versus unmanned. You'll see a lot of words, even in the most recent shipbuilding plan, we use the term optionally manned or optionally unmanned, depending on what side of that equation you want to sit on. But we think that'll be a bridge to getting around some of the ethical discussions that go on about unmanned. Hey, we can put people on these things if we need to, and then maybe in a conflict we'll pull them off. You know, these are all the con ops that we're coming through, but we're investing in large platforms, medium platforms, small platforms, the whole spectrum, cross domain, and you know, very excited to see what that capability brings. We're already opining what these things might do in war games. A lot of studies have war game informed have made opinions on how these things might be used, and we think that's a very healthy dialogue to be having, especially with the think tank community, on how might these things be employed. So I think we are demonstrating as much commitment as we possibly can while still sustaining today's force and then keeping, you know, at least a solid foot in a canoe with the capability we know works today that the fleet does need. So we'll see how this develops over the next few years.
Let me ask you just a technical question that I often get asked, which is, at what point will the Navy start counting unmanned vessels in its ship count? And everybody recognizes that ship count is a very poor metric for naval strength.
Exactly.
You know, it counts tugs, you know, with aircraft carriers. It's, on the other hand, it is the one that everyone uses.
Yeah.
So it has a lot of
I mean, there's a lot of value in how you account for the ships, both funding-wise, legal reasons why, and just to speak in the same language when we're talking about the shipbuilding accounts and procurement. But the reality from the warfare systems guy, I don't really care how we count them. To me, it's all about naval capability and effective naval power. The only point where I get very concerned is if you talk about replacing battle force ships with unmanned systems that are not proven, which kind of gets to the last discussion. And once they are proven, then we can see how that would affect the accounting. But right now, we're just very committed to make sure these things complement and contribute to the battle force. How we account for them, that's a very personal relationship between the Secretary of the Navy and Congress. And they're aware of it. We have these discussions all the time. We all kind of agree we're just not ready to count these things as ships. We just don't know what they can do yet. But when the time comes, as long as it's viewed through the lens of total naval power, we'll count them for whatever the community is comfortable with.
You raised the 355 ship goal, and I think that certainly through the Trump administration, since the president has said that that's the goal, the Navy will stick to it one way or the other. But you mentioned that the mix of ships might be different, and when one looks at the Navy shipbuilding program, it looks like the Navy may be hinting that it will move to some different kinds of ships, looking at maybe the amphibs instead of a relatively small number of very capable ships, maybe some smaller ships in larger numbers, maybe the same thing on some of the surface
right.
combatants. Do you see a movement in that direction, or is that just one of the things that's being considered for the future?
I'm not sure I see you know, any specific ship line doing any kind of dramatic change because they're all kind of, when we go through all the modeling, they're all interconnected. So if I change the balance from a lot of large surface combatants to a lot of small surface combatants, which we are today, to a force that has a much larger small surface combatant base and fewer ones, and then how that feeds into number of aircraft carriers, number of amphibs, the numbers may go up, the numbers may go down. You know, there's always some surprises when the FSA comes out. And that's why we red team it. We pull in a lot of external organizations to see, grade the Navy's homework. We had five of those done last time. And they all had different opinions, but they all kind of converged that the FSA was about right. And they all agreed that the Navy had to be bigger. So regardless of how many people look at it, a few themes typically emerge. And what we think is going to happen with this FSA is there will be more emphasis on the smaller surface combatants. mostly because the frigate looks like it's coming along very well. It's going to be more lethal than we had planned. And if you, all the resource sponsors are in N9. Ron Boxall does the surface fleet. You know, he does this thing with his arms about we're like this now. Way too many large surface. We need to get more balanced. And when you look at the lethality of the frigate, yeah, that makes sense. So we'll see how the FSA handles the lethality of that, and then how does that bleed over into all the other accounts. You know, amphibs, we are constantly defending those like we're defending the aircraft carrier. And again, our response is you have to look at the full spectrum of what these things can do, when they can do it, where they can do it. And same with every other ship line. And the FSA does a very good job of that. It takes all the demands of all the COCOMs, not just a fully developed conflict, and it puts that into the blender, the models, and it spits out a result. And then the team of warfighters evaluates that result versus what the COCOMs want. We bounce it off of them, we bounce it off the independent study teams, bounce off the red team, and then in the end, by the end of the year, we'll have a new FSA. I think there'll be a hard look at the logistics side. As you know, in logistics, some ships are counted as battle force ships, some are not. The FSA will make an opinion on battle force ships, but it'll look at all the ones that are not battle force also. So it doesn't just limit itself for what is, you know, under that strict definition, kind of similar to the other conversation. And we know we have to focus more on those kinds of capability. Takes into account the evolution of the air wing, the length of the air wing, the increasing range of the air wing on number of ships, how we're going to cover down on our responsibilities. So I guess what I'm telling you is complex. And it's, for me to opine on any particular ship line in isolation is kind of similar to our opening conversation. That's like looking at a single slice of the threat cube. You know, kind of Battle of Jutland-like approach, which is a fight we know we're not going to fight. Well, similar to the FSA, you have to look at it in totality, how the different domains complement each other to meet the outcome desired by the COCOMs. And that's how we drive it. Then you add all those up, you get a number, and that's how we got 355.
One quick follow-on about the unmanned systems. You mentioned that the Navy was moving very aggressively in that, mm-hmm. in that area. You can see that in the budget and the program. But one place the Navy has had some criticism is on the air component. And some people in particularly the think tanks, have argued that the Navy should go faster on the unmanned air component, maybe making the MQ-25 a strike aircraft. Where is the Navy on that, and does it believe that you could go faster?
So the MQ-25, we think is just a fantastic program. But it kind of goes to the larger discussion about unmanned. We have to get this thing out there. We have yet to integrate an unmanned aircraft into the air wing. Support, sortie rates, efficacy of just what it's designed to do. But it's a fairly big aircraft. It's robust. It's billed as a tanker, but it's probably the stepping stone to other capabilities, and we'll just see how it evolves. Can we go fast with the MQ-25? Not likely. I mean, it's already designated as one of our maritime accelerated acquisition programs, which means we kind of move everything out of the way to make sure it's got the funding it needs, it gets the support it needs. And as a matter of fact, I just got an update this morning. It's very much on track, and we're very excited to get that into the fleet. You know, what is perceived to be somewhat of a linear approach to unmanned, I think as you see these get to the fleet and we start playing with them, you're going to start seeing that curve bend, you know, pretty quickly, just like you see in other technologies. We are just compelled to be, you know, somewhat pragmatic in how well they work before we overcommit. You know, we have a limited budget. We also have real lives at stake. Unmanned is not really unmanned. You just don't have a body sitting in the platform. There's a lot of support. There's a lot of, especially the MQ-25, you have deck handling. Just a lot of things you got to come through in the complexity of bringing these aboard a maritime environment. Very excited about it. We think we're leaning into it as hard as is practical.
Let me ask one last question, which was not on our list, but I believe you commanded NR1.
I did.
And deep sea exploration has been in the news the last week because there's been a series of dives very deep. And I was wondering if you just wanted to say anything about deep sea exploration from your experience there.
I was disappointed to hear that they found plastic bags at the bottom of the Mariana Trench, which is, you know, 35,000 feet underwater. You know, deep sea, it's still kind of in that category of we would know more about the backside of the moon than we do about the floor of our own oceans. So when we walked away from manned deep sea exploration, you know, there was an expectation that we're going to be able to quickly replace that capability with remotely operated vehicles, unmanned vehicles, and those efforts kind of stalled. But I think we're on track to open up that whole water column again. And reading that article of revisiting the Marianas Trench just kind of regenerates the enthusiasm for what is possible on the seafloor. But it is part of our spectrum of vertical domains. And when we talk about domains, and we now talk from space to the seafloor. And we have a whole collection of investments going after all of those. So there's a lot of interest to open up the entire water column, and I'm pretty comfortable with the attention we're paying to that.
Great. Well, I think this is an opportunity to open it up for questions. Gentleman right here got the first hand up.
Sure, George Nicholson, the Washington liaison for the Global Special Operations Forces Foundation. You talked about the unmanned tanker. I remember talking to Riley Nixon, Admiral Nixon, that during Desert Storm, he had his four carriers in the Red Sea, and he laughed and told me that it took two aerial refuelings to get him up over his fighters over Iraq, and two to get back. Go back to Vietnam, where our fighters had A6 had a 1,500-mile combat radius. All our current platforms, Navy F-18s, Air Force F-15s, F-22s, F-35, have got less than that. I remember talking to Admiral Pandolf when he came back with his carrier battle group off the coast of Pakistan supporting operations in Afghanistan. He laughed and said that was simple. It took two aerial refuelings to get my aircraft up overhead Afghanistan, one in the area and two to come back. With the emerging threats right now that General Deptula over at AFA has talked about, the Chinese specifically developing missiles to take out J-STARS, Hawkeye, and AWACS. And he said the next on their plate is to take out those tankers. You can have these new source of unmanned tankers, mm-hmm. but if we've got the short range on the fighters, how do you address that?
So at the risk of not delving into specific capabilities, and we've kind of walked away from those discussions, which is another reflection of a great power competition. Don't talk so much. The reach of the air wing is why we invest in an aircraft carrier to begin with. And we always encourage people to focus on the weapon system, the air wing, not the airfield, which is the platform. And we're very comfortable with the platform. We continue to invest and extend the range. The MQ-25 is a piece of that. You know, the good news is we do this every single day. We didn't just do it against Kosovo, Iraq, Afghanistan. We're out there doing it every single day, and we have very clear view of what the carrier can and cannot reach. The range of the aircraft kind of moves around. I mean, that's physics, and we always say not just cool, it's a law. If you want to go further, you got to carry more fuel. If you want to go faster, you got to carry more fuel. You want to carry ordnance, you got to go shorter. So all these are competing requirements. One thing we have done, we've extended the range of the weapon systems on the aircraft themselves. So when you talk about range, we always talk about it in effective range. So it's the aircraft, the tanking, and the range of the weapon. But also, we are very quick to remind everybody that, again, that's a Battle of Jutland discussion. It's the length of reach of the air wing versus the threat to the air wing. It doesn't account to all the other ways we may deal with that threat before we ever put the air wing into that position. And there's a very strong temporal aspect to this. Maybe you don't use the air wing the way you want on day one, but on day 10, it evolves very quickly as you bring all the other capabilities together. We do that analysis all the time. And the air wing always scores very well with us once you put it in concert with the rest of the capabilities of the Navy. And again, one of the reasons that we are so confident in our investment in that capability. I mean, the carrier, the air wing, has proven to be about the most adaptable platforms we've ever built. Enterprise was considered to be obsolete 50 years ago, and we evolved her, and she's still capable to her last day. Matter of fact, she was more capable on her last day than on her first day. And your question, you know, it's very much a classified question in an unclassified setting. So when I bring in, you know, that right half of my brain, which is, you know, a key element to how we employ the force, this is how we get to the answer. And I would offer that my team is probably more progressive in thought on the viability and survivability of that carrier or any other platform, because we're the ones that have to live with it. So when you do the cross-domain effects and it keeps scoring out, you know, we, that's why we feel so confident. It's an honest view. It's a look that we wire brush very hard. And in the end, these are the capabilities we think we need. I don't know if that helps you or not. I know I talked around it a little bit, but I am very loath to get into specific capabilities in public forums anymore.
Okay, Harlan.
Waiting for Mike or
something? Yeah, well, I can hear you. You can start, but here, Mike is coming.
I'm Harlan Ullman. Most recently, I sat on the board of the Education for Sea Power Review. My question is really conceptually, how do you deal with the two real existential threats to the joint force and, by extension, the naval force? As you know, the Secretary of the Navy just released a report on cyber, in which the conclusion was that Chinese and, by extension, Russian capacity to penetrate our networks and steal stuff is existential. Mm-hmm. And second, nuclear weapons. I just came back from Moscow a couple of weeks ago. As you know, the Soviet Union made no distinction between nuclear and conventional weapons. The Gerasimov doctrine intimates the same. My Russian colleague said, we're not worried about a carrier strike group. Supposing we pop a nuclear weapon exoatmospherically and take everything out with EMP, it's not even an act of war. So conceptually, how are you dealing with what the Secretary of the Navy believes to be an existential threat, cyber, and what the bad guys are doing to us? And secondly, the unspoken issue about nuclear weapons, especially when the Russians have a huge majority of tactical weapons compared to us.
Right. Those are a couple of softballs. The cyber report we found was very helpful. It didn't really identify much that we didn't already know we were dealing with, but it was very helpful in pulling in a lot of people that may help us with the solution set. So cyber is one of these things we've made a lifestyle. As we design and build, cyber resiliency is a big piece of this. And it's not just the resiliency, it's suffering a cyber attack and the healability of our systems. Obviously very important for a Navy that projects overseas where we have a lot of people, as we say, alone and unafraid. Are you gonna be able to fight your platform in regardless of the environment? And some would argue we're already in a cyber war. Those boundaries are very loose. There's no law of armed conflict in the cyber domain. It's just an effect you're gonna have to deal with. And whether you're offensive or defensive, we're very aggressive at understanding, you know, both sides of that equation, how we're gonna deal with it. If you look back over the last few years, I don't have to tell you how committed we are. We stood up 10 fleet, we have cyber forces, we have information warfare command, we have new communities. All this is designed at getting after that element. And it's not just the operators. Go to the Navy Yard, NAV-C, NAV-AIR, they have entire teams devoted to just keeping track of the threat. It's probably an area that we're married most closely with industry. Industry deals with this all the time. If you're a banker, you're dealing with people's livelihood here, and whenever you see a breach, a cyber attack, you see the reaction it gets and how seriously I think we as Americans just take this threat. So, another area where we've invested heavily, I think we're seeing returns on it, and as I said, it's gonna be a lifestyle going forward. As far as the nuclear threat, it's a triad. We base our nuclear capabilities on a deterrence posture. It's a second strike deterrent posture. By our analysis, it's still the strategy, the law of the land. It's disappointing that we're struggling so much with Russia on their interpretation of the policies. I'm not a policy heavy, so I can't wander too far in that world. But the fact that we are investing in the Columbia class and we continue to recapitalize, we feel like we're in good shape supporting the strategy that the president's laid out. And we just had a new nuclear posture review that reviewed all those threats, and I still think we're on the right path. I'll let you go.
The lady right there.
Thank you. My name is Anita Parlo. I was a Fulbright in Iceland, and I worked on a Wilson project at Wilson on the bearing in terms of the polar code. And I was in China last week, and it had to do with Iceland and China, believe it, working together in terms of Arctic policy, which I've been working on for the past 5 years. So something Secretary Pompeo said in Rovaniemi in Finland, where the folks came from there to China, shocked folks. He talked about the Arctic policy in the Arctic states and then the near Arctic states in the context of being concerned, great power concern militarily, to use your terms, with respect to viewing China and Russia, Russia being half of the Arctic, as potential enemies. Everyone was shocked, they sucked in their breaths, and then they went to China. And so my question is, what does that mean? And you may be out of your wheelhouse here, I wouldn't appreciate it if you might speculate off the record. Is how
we're being recorded, so
Turn the lights off, turn the cameras off. That's probably not going to happen.
But there was quite a shock, as you know. Cooperation in the Arctic has been the sort of expressions since Gorbachev talked about the zone of peace. What is the readiness posture? What does that mean in terms of collaboration and cooperation with our allies up in the Nordic North? Is it sort of dividing up the Arctic, I'm sorry about this, in a certain sense before we even start? I'm just wondering, what is the dynamic, and how does the political posture and the military readiness posture, how do they dovetail together? Thank you much.
So this will be probably understandably a fairly short answer. The Arctic is another ocean that is, in our portfolio of the globe. We're very active in the Arctic. We keep an eye on the Arctic. We're very comfortable in the Arctic. Our Navy's up there quite a bit, really no more or less than we ever have. It's just part of our routine area that we have a presence in. Great power competition means a global competition. So wherever they go, we go. If we're already there, great. If not, then we'll have to adjust. It is out of my wheelhouse. I won't talk policy. I won't talk about the relationships with China and Russia regarding the Arctic. But from a capability standpoint, where my role is, we are comfortable in the Arctic. We're working with the Coast Guard. We're reconstituting the icebreaking fleet, very, very tight at the hip there. We're bringing our systems aboard their icebreakers, and we're helping them with the ship design with NAVC. And it's just part of the evolution of this, this expanding challenge. We're keeping an eye on it like every other part of the world.
Gentleman over there.
Yeah, thank you. I'm Mark Tokola with the Korea Economic Institute. How important is interoperability with our allies' navies? And what capabilities do they have that are important to us?
Great question. I would say our commitment to our allies and interoperability is 100% complete, especially with the high-end allies that we work with day in and day out. As we try to nurture more relationships with the allies, it's a pretty set model. We try to bring them along with the capabilities we have and make sure that they can plug in as they can support. We always have to respect that allies are their own sovereign nations. So how they are going to contribute to a unperceived conflict in the future, that's up for them to decide. But if they come through that on their own and they do want to contribute, it's supremely important to us that they can plug into the systems that we have today. And we work very hard on that. We have a very effective officer right now over in the Navy International Programs Office, Admiral Morley. And he has just done a terrific job of sustaining these relationships with the allies that are interested. Above all else, especially the overseas allies, access is what we rely on, regardless of their sovereign position on whatever conflict we may be facing. Access is always going to be important to us. We are very sustainable at sea, but it's harder that way. If we can access ports and resupplies, that's obviously very, very important to us. And the capabilities any allies brings is obviously very beneficial. It's interesting, you know, I've spent much of my career overseas, and the U.S. Navy view of the Allies is often different than the Allies' view of the Allies. We often start conversations, oh, you're a big Navy, we're little, what can we possibly do? Where our view is, we just count the players on the field. And if you bring players with the capability, if you're on the team, we throw you a jersey, and you're on the team when we go, which makes everybody more healthy. And that can be very revealing to the Allies' view of how we look at them and bring them into the fight, that we don't just look at them as an adjunct, we look at them as an integrated partner, and we do everything we can to make it easy for them to join us, exercise with us, and if it comes to it, fight with us.
Question, let's see, in the back there in the corner, the lady.
That would be Megan.
Hi, Megan Eckstein, USNI News. You talked about the balance between readiness, capacity, and capability. Congress tends to like giving you guys money for more capacity with additional ships. You made the pitch really well in recent years about readiness funding, and you said you're digging out of that pit. But I wonder on the capability side, kind of how you make the argument to get energy behind, you know, C4I upgrades for your amphibs, enhanced radars for your destroyers, and other capability upgrades like that that you've been talking about.
Yeah, thank you for that question, Megan. This is a very important point that, you know, drove the imbalance, one of our earlier discussions about this readiness and capability. Congress has become very supportive and sympathetic of that challenge. So we use a rough thumb rule for a conventionally powered ship that it's about 30% to buy it, 70% to own it over its lifetime. So when we get a ship that we didn't ask for or it's above the requirement, you know, we build it and we lob it over the fence into the readiness accounts, and it, you know, adds to that burden. Probably the most positive outcome of all the dialogue we've had on this readiness challenge and getting, as we say, the pot right here between readiness and capability was a direction of Congress this year to add Appendix 5 to the shipbuilding plan. Say, hey, Navy, we want you to explain this long-term readiness and sustainment challenge. You know, what is it really going to cost to own and operate a 355 ship Navy, plus all the other ships we buy to support that Navy? And it was, you know, it was revealing to us as we've been learning our business better and better as we've been trying to drive this balance that, you know, one of the revealing points is we've been shrinking the Navy over the last 40 years as opposed to growing it. So we don't even have the complex modeling to really understand what all these costs are going to materialize to 20 years down the road. Neither does the Congressional Budget Office or anybody else, because we've just kind of gotten into this mode that it'll take care of itself because we're going to be smaller when we get there. So we've been working very hard with all the external organizations so we can converge on a model so we can, you know, at least use a common base to predict what this cost is going to be. And a lot of that's been driven by, you know, the very stark evidence that when you fall out of balance, people get hurt. And as you try to, you know, burn the candle at three different ends, something, one of those flames is going to go out effectively. So when we talk about the balance of readiness, capability, and capacity, it's kind of a multiplication equation. If any of those go to zero, the whole equation goes to zero. And that's a, you know, kind of a dramatic example, but we were certainly showing signs of heading in that direction. And we've been able to, we think, effectively turn those curves. You know, the investments we've put in readiness over the last 3 years are just starting to materialize into report backs, output metrics that are really making a difference. You know, just look at our Hornet fleet on how much better it's doing. Some of it was investment, but a lot of it was just understanding the business, changing the processes, and being able to use the resources we had a lot more effectively. We couldn't ask for a better partner than we've had with Congress over the last few years on this crusade to get this balance right. And I think them directing us to explain the sustainment challenge was a very positive step in the right direction. And we're continuing those dialogues.
Okay, yeah, the gentleman right over there, and I think that's going to be our last question.
Hi, Sam Lagrone, also with USNI News. Just to follow up on some of the conversation with the MQ-25A, moving forward, a lot of potential adversaries and allies has identified unmanned carrier aviation as a real growth in capabilities that they're looking at. The next French carrier is supposedly designed around a UCAV of you know domestic European design. It seems the MQ-25A is a bridge to something else. How's the work coming, or what's the look at for the something else? And not to quote another study at you, Admiral, but Brian Clark's CSBA Air Wing, Future Air Wing study talked a lot about you know, 1,000-mile standoff distance and UCAV caps for a new program. Can you give us any insight on where y'all with that thought process? Thank you.
Sure. We do look at it as a stepping stone, as a bridge. It obviously generates a lot of creative thought, not just within the Navy, but you know the Brian Clarks of the world and a lot of the think tanks that we work with regularly. And we work with them regularly because we value their opinion on how they open up the aperture and help us think about this. But it is conceptual right now. Until we get this thing into the fleet and see how it survives in a sea environment and how it integrates with the air wing, I think it will be very much informative of going bigger or smaller, longer, shorter, more payload, and more, frankly, more mission sets. The four-class carrier is kind of designed to handle all that. You know, the new catapult system is much more scalable to lighter aircraft and to heavier aircraft. Steam catapult right now would, you know, rip the wings off of a small UAV if you had to launch it off the front of the ship. So as we design these capital platforms, when we talk about reserving space, weight, power, communications for future capabilities, this is what we're talking about. It's not just more. It could be smaller. It could be lighter. We just have to cover this spectrum of possibility for a ship that's going to be around for 50 years. And that's, you know, that's a balance that's, you know, very hard to strike. Carriers has proven to be about our most adaptable platform, but the air wing, we think, is going to evolve in all kinds of directions here as we start bringing these manned and unmanned teams together.
Well, thank you. Our time has expired. Please join me in thanking Admiral Merz for joining us this morning.
Thanks, John.
Well, thank you for joining us.
That was great.